Hello, and welcome to another episode of Champaign Connection. I'm Rick Atterbury, your host. Drivers in Champaign can now avoid the hassle of fumbling for loose change or running back to feed an expiring parking meter. We'll talk with Public Works about MobileMeter, a new app that lets drivers conveniently pay for parking. Plus, after a long, cold winter, spring is finally here, which means crews are hard at work repairing the city streets and private construction is booming. We'll get the inside scoop on all the projects happening around town this summer. And the Champaign Police Department wants the community to get involved and help shape the future of community policing. Find out what they're doing to engage the community in this important effort and how you can join in the discussion. It's another great episode you won't want to miss. This episode of Champaign Connection starts now. Our guest is Chris Kester, the Administrative Services Manager and Public Information Officer in Public Works. Welcome back to the show, Chris.
Thanks, Rick. It's good to be here.
Understand that you guys have come up with a new, maybe more convenient way for people to use the parking meters.
Yes, the city is very excited to announce the launch of a program called MobileMeter. It is a web-based app that's developed by Passport Parking that will allow people to pay at the parking meter via their telephone using a credit card.
So how does that work? Do I set up an account? How does that work?
There are a few different ways. The easiest, as I mentioned, was the app. So if you have an iPhone or an Android, you can download that for free. You'll create your account, assign a security PIN, load your credit card information in there, update your vehicle information, and then you'll use the information that you find on the sticker on the front of the meter with the zone number and the meter number and choose the amount of time that you'd like to pay for. Once you choose that amount of time, you'll get a confirmation that tells you that you've paid for the time. The meter will still flash zero because it's not integrated into the meter technology. But the convenience is that about 15 minutes before your meter expires, you'll get a notification letting you know that your meter is about to expire.
It just occurred to me, can I set up more than one license plate number on my account?
You sure can. It's based on your telephone number, so you can have as many license plates on there as you want. We are working with the company to develop one that's more business related for larger businesses who have multiple vehicles, but individuals can use more than one vehicle on their account at this time.
Well, that'd be a great service to people who run a fleet.
Yes, yeah, we're very excited about, hopefully we'll have that up and running by the end of the year.
Does it cost anything beyond the regular parking rate for people to use this service?
There is a small 25-cent convenience fee that is charged. You are notified about the total of your parking rate plus the convenience fee, and so you do pay that. However, if you're at a meter that allows you to extend your parking time, you can extend your time for free with no convenience fee and only the additional parking time.
So once you start a transaction, that transaction kind of open until
yes.
It really expires.
Exactly.
If I don't use apps, if I don't have a smartphone, can I still participate?
Yes, there are two other options. One is if you have internet access on your phone, or even if you're at your office computer, you can go to mobilemeter.us, or you can call from your cell phone, which is the phone number 217-207-3033.
And that's on the stickers on the meters.
Absolutely.
Is my credit card information secure? The university's had a similar system for a couple of years, and I've always been a little hesitant because I've been burned a couple times with my credit cards.
Sure. We believe that our answer to that is yes. Your information is secure. None of it is stored on the city's databases, and none of it is stored on Passport's databases as well. It's all kept on an off-site credit card storage only facility, and that's usually best practices in the industry.
And talking about using this at the meters have various lengths. There are other rules for some of them, and some of them change lengths and time of day. Do all the other rules still apply?
Yes, all the other rules do apply. The easiest way to see the amount of time that's available for you to park at a meter is by looking at the large sticker that's located on the post of the meter. They're usually different colors depending on what the amount of time is, and it tells you the hours of enforcement as well as the maximum amount of time that you can park there.
So the system knows that the particular meter I'm at might be a two-hour meter, And if I try to extend beyond 2 hours, does the app say, no, you don't?
Yes, we've built that into the system, and so everything in the system is designed within the city's guidelines of what we enforce our parking meters as.
What kind of systems did you look at before you settled on this one?
We did look at other systems that offer similar services. There's a lot of different technology out there. There's credit card meters. There's meters where you load something on a small device that then you place in your window. And so we felt that with our current infrastructure, as well as being able to keep the cost down, that having a mobile payment app for use by our existing meters was the best route to go, and most within the city's budget.
I recall when you tested credit card meters, but that required changing every meter head, if I remember right.
Correct. There were some prohibitive things that made that a successful program. Number one, the technology itself, so the meter head itself, costs about 4 to 5 times more than a mechanical meter, as well as there's additional recurring costs, like each meter had to have a cell phone signal and more credit card transaction fees with those, as well as updated maintenance.
Do you foresee a time where maybe in some new lots there's no conventional meter head, but you use this electronic system exclusively?
That is always a possibility. There are many cities and municipalities that have very similar to what you just described, where you pull in and you see signs everywhere that tell you, use your phone to pay. The City of Champaign has not talked about that, but that's always an option that we could explore, which would save us money on infrastructure, as well as use a system that's currently in place.
So for the foreseeable future, I can still dip into the change jar on the dresser before I head.
That's correct. We also, still are accepting cash keys. At most of those, that technology is going out at some point, in the future. But as of right now, you can still use now 3 different methods to pay for your parking meter.
So really, there's no infrastructure cost at the meter end of things, but you've had to do different things on the back end to be able to, so the meter readers know what your status is.
Yes, that's correct. So that's how, like I mentioned, that your meter will still flash 0. However, our parking enforcement officers have the technology on their current handhelds that they log into the system, and they verify that the meter that you're parked at, if it doesn't show that it's paid with coin, is paid with mobile meter.
This is really going to be convenient, I think.
Yes, we're very excited about it.
Thanks, Chris.
Thanks, Rick.
The new mobile meter app is an easy and convenient way for drivers to pay for parking in the City of Champaign. To learn more or set up your free account, visit mobilemeter.us. Our guests are Dave Clark, city engineer, and Rob Kowalski, the assistant planning and development director. Welcome back to the show.
Thank you, Rick.
Thank you.
Dave, we'll start with you. It's infrastructure construction season again, and what are some of the projects we'll be looking at this year?
First, we have a continuation of a project that we started last summer in 2014, which is the extension of Olympian Drive in the northeast part of Champaign, a project between Apollo Drive in Champaign that extends over to Lincoln Avenue in Urbana. It's a large state and federally funded highway project. It also includes funding from the Illinois Commerce Commission to build the new bridge that will extend over the Canadian National Illinois Central Railroad tracks. It's a joint project with City of Champaign, City of Urbana, and Champaign County. Our contractor is Foyt's Construction. The construction cost is about $7.1 million. And as I said, they started that project last summer, and they're going to be working all this construction season, and they expect to wrap up next year in 2016, summer of 2016. So it's a large project. A sister project to that is the extension of Olympian Drive to the west. In the northwest part of Champaign. We have in Clearview subdivision a long section of Olympian Drive that ends, and this project will pick up from that point and extend it west to Duncan Road. That's a project we're going to start here probably around June, and should be able to wrap that up within this construction season, and it'll be open later this fall. We don't have a contractor just yet. It's still on the streets for bidding. But the construction cost estimate is around $1.5 million. So once we have both sections completed, someone will be able to drive from Duncan Road in Champaign all the way over to Lincoln Avenue. So we're looking forward and really excited to have that whole route available for public use. So those are two big projects we have going on. A third we have is the reconstruction of South Mattis Avenue. This is a project south of Curtis Road. It's essentially a project to replace the old oil and chip road with a new concrete pavement. We'll be finishing the project to a point a little south of Congressional Drive. And in addition to the new pavement, we'll have new LED streetlights for that section as well. So those are the three really big projects we have to look forward to this construction season. And of course, we have a number of our annual maintenance projects that will be going on throughout the city, throughout the construction season.
There are always more projects that people would like to do, that you would like to do, than there is time or budget. How do you prioritize?
That's a very good question. People are always interested in knowing how we decide to work where we work, because as you said, there's a lot of locations that need work, but we can't get to all of them. We have to prioritize things based on the amount of money that we have to work with on an annual basis. Basically, how we prioritize work is we look at the existing condition of the infrastructure. Is it failing? Any critical safety problems as a result of it's getting too old, or is it falling apart? So we look at the condition of the infrastructure. We consider neighborhood requests, citizen input goes into it. We consider our the problems that our operations section, the public works operation crew, they get called out to work in various parts of the city, and they'll let us know, hey, we're having trouble with this particular area, and it's getting away from them. So we'll try to get that put into a project and respond to their needs as well. We factor in council goals and priorities, so a lot of that comes together. And about this time each year, a group of public works staff, we get together and we look at our multi-year plan. So we're looking at about a three-year planning horizon that we kind of work with our projects on. We'll review those priorities and those lists, and we'll make adjustments based on how things survive the winter. Winters are pretty tough around here. There's occasions where we'll have to move a project up to be able to respond to how well it did over the winter. Some projects, they don't get moved because they survived well. Other projects, the winter was especially rough on them, and so we've got to move it up and address those kind of problems.
Rob, let's talk a little bit about things going on in the private sector. We've all seen what's going on Green Street, but now it looks like there's a lot of apartment construction going on East University. What are some of the things that are happening?
Yeah, there is considerable apartment development happening in Campus Town and on East University Avenue for students and young professionals that have a desire to live close to the center of town. Three of note that residents may see, of course, the project at 4th and Green is called HERE, H-E-R-E. That's the 20-story mid-rise, if you will, or high-rise for us.
For us, yes.
That's nearing completion and will be occupied in the next few months. The West Quad Apartments is the name of the development that is at Green and Locust. So if you're traveling on Neal Street, now you're seeing something come up above the railroad tracks there. That's called West Quad. And then one that folks aren't able to see yet because it hasn't started but will start very soon is called Latitude. And that will be two separate five-story buildings on the north side of University Avenue between Wright and Fifth Street. So that's it's our entryway into the city of Champaign.
A lot of apartment construction, but there's a lot of non-apartment construction planned now, too.
Yeah, there is. Several projects around town, again, that some folks can see and some that aren't as visible yet. Of course, there is an expansion of Marketplace Mall happening right now. That will accommodate 100,000 square feet of new retail space that will be divided into two stores. Dick's Sporting Goods will relocate from their store on North Prospect, and then the other 50,000 square feet will be Field & Stream, which is a new store for our area here. It's a outdoor sporting goods store, so with an emphasis on fishing, hunting, and outdoor recreation. And a lot of people may think, well, that's just replacing the Sears store, but it's really not. If you go out to the mall, you'll notice a major part of the parking lot is being filled in with new building space. So it significantly adds square footage. Those stores will be connected from the mall, but they will also have exterior entrances too, and quite a nice visual presence from Neal Street. Just a note about the mall, we are so fortunate in this community to have a mall that continues to grow and stay healthy and thrives. There are many communities that are figuring out what to do with their dying malls, and we continue to enjoy the luxury of having such a great mall.
And then we've got the old carriage center being redeveloped. That's exciting because it's near my office. So I'm looking forward to some of the stores that are coming.
Well, yeah, you should have a greater choice of places to grab something to eat or to get some groceries. That's another project that folks have probably seen occurring for quite some time. It took a while to demolish the existing buildings, and now we're seeing stuff come out of the ground, if you will. That will include a county market grocery store, an Ace Hardware store, a Hilton Home2 hotel, and then several different restaurants, including Brick's Pizza, a Starbucks, Pancheros, and Moe's Southwestern Grill. Those will probably be along the Neal Street frontage and the bigger stores in the back. So that's a significant redevelopment that will really serve that area very nicely.
What are some of the major impacts of these private developments, the apartments and other private developments on the city?
Well, there's significant impacts to these projects. For apartments, a lot of people may say, well, it's just another student apartment building. But there's really three major impacts to these developments we're seeing in the core of the city. First one is just economic development. Some of these projects are valued at tens of millions of dollars. For example, the Latitude project is a $50 million construction project. That all contributes greatly to the local tax revenues, not just for the city, but the school district, the park district, mass transit district, and all the other taxing bodies. And there's absolutely no public subsidy giving to those developments as well. So it's really a nice economic development tool. Secondly, a lot of these buildings are what we call mixed use, where the first floor there are shops, commercial services, and then apartments above. The shops, of course, provide opportunities for jobs and additional places for all residents to shop. And then finally, there's a value to these projects being built in the middle of the city. We call it infill, where the roads already exist, the fire, the police, the sewers, they're all there already. So it's a much more economical way to grow, as opposed to those being on the fringe of town where we've got to spend a lot of money and provide those services. So it saves the taxpayers a lot of dollars in that respect, too.
Since we've got both of you here, we've never done that before. How do you work together? Obviously, what happens in the private sector is going to impact projects in the public center to provide the infrastructure. How do you guys work together on a daily basis?
Our departments work closely together through monthly planning and project coordination meetings. There's a group of us that gets together at least once a month to review not only private developments but also any kind of capital projects that we'll be working on and the impacts to the surrounding properties that those projects would have. Also, each winter, when we update the city's budget process, there's opportunities there to coordinate and plan for future projects in the 10-year CIP budget. There's also another group that gets together called the Development Service Team that meets on a weekly basis that coordinates mostly on development-related issues. But there is a lot of coordination between the two departments. You almost have to. There's just so much going on.
Yeah, I'll add to that. There's an important relationship with planners and engineers. You've got the side that's helping create a vision for the community, all the way down to the details of actually making it a tangible outcome. So we work together quite well in putting those two things together. A great example is the reconstruction of Green Street through Campus Town. You know, starts as a vision of what do we want this area to become, how do we want this corridor to look. And then eventually, you have to get down to the details of how will this road be built, how will it be designed, and those are where these two disciplines come together. We're very fortunate in Champaign to have a great relationship between our planners and our engineers, the two disciplines that have to work together very well.
Well, we're glad to hear that. We appreciate both of you being here today.
Thank you. Thank you.
New construction and development projects are always popping up all around town. For the latest information on the road closures and other city projects, check out the city's website at ci.champaign.il.us. Our guests are Police Chief Anthony Cobb and Deputy Police Chief Joe Gallo. You've both been here before, so welcome back.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Chief, tell us why the strategic plan is important and then what went into recreating it.
Okay. A strategic plan is very important to our organization because it's the foundation. It's how we communicate to our community as well as to our staff what we're doing, where we're going, how we're going to get there. What went into our strategic plan is we had a third-party consultant work with us, and we started small group discussions with our employees. Through those small group discussions, we created a survey, and that survey was information that we gave to every employee and gave them a chance to give us feedback on it. It wasn't an option for them to fill it out. We required them to do so, and our employees were wonderful. They gave us some great feedback of things that they thought we should do in order to make the service that we provide to citizens that much better. Once we got that information, we took the time to sit down and work with a core planning committee that consisted of employees, as well as citizens, employee spouses, as well as retirees, other department council member was on it. And then we looked at what are the things, the raw data that we compile. And from there, that's how we created a mission, vision, and guiding principles that we're gonna be sharing with our community over the next couple of weeks.
Joe, I hear part of the plan addresses exercising a concept called unconditional respect. What does that mean?
Sure. Unconditional respect is really the heart of our mission statement and our guiding principles. Unconditional respect is having honor and regard for one another, regardless of our differences. It speaks to how we view and treat each other, both internally at the police department and externally for the citizens that we serve. Now, we're still going to arrest those that violate the law and hold them accountable, but when we do so, we're going to treat them with dignity and respect.
Yes.
Chief, do you think it's important to get the public's assistance in fighting crime? You sought a lot of input from the public putting this together. Now we need help from them.
Always need help from our public. Recognize we're public servants and we serve our public. In order for us to be successful in holding people accountable for their actions, we have to collaborate and partner with our citizens. They are the eyes and ears of the police department. They help guide and direct us. But at the same token, we want to make sure we're policing in a manner that they're comfortable with. We want feedback. We want their input to make sure we're taking on the issues and problems that are unique to their neighborhoods. We have a lot of wonderful neighborhoods within our community, and they're uniquely different. And we want to make sure we provide the quality service that they desire.
And the plan recognizes that you can't do it alone.
That is correct.
Joe, I read that you want to allocate resources based on intelligence-led policing. What does that mean? How does Champaign do that?
Sure. As you're aware, we have limited resources and we have to use them wisely. Intelligence-led policing is essentially using data to help us determine where and when our resources should be deployed. For example, if we're having a rash of burglaries in a certain part of town between 1 and 3 p.m., that's where we want our officers to be. So it really speaks to, you know, using the data to help us place our officers in the right part of town at the right time of day.
And this is beyond sticking pins in a map. You can do a lot more now.
Absolutely. Technology is really at our fingertips, and we can run queries on just about anything to see what's going on in our community.
Let's talk about technology, Chief. Mm-hmm. How important is it to the police department, and how is that changing the way you do what you do?
We're really looking to embrace technology. We're at a nice point within the history of our department where we have some capital improvements that are coming about, so we can look and take the opportunity to leverage some resources. We're about at the point where we're going to look at replacing our records management system at some point over the next 3 to 5 years or so. We'll be looking at replacing N-Squad computers as well as radios. There's an opportunity our community may move to look at e-ticketing. So there's a lot of technology things that are happening out there. And so it's our opportunity to explore and look at that. Body cameras or something on the horizon. There's a lot of conversation about tasers in our community as well. So there's a lot of technology that we can be looking at, examining, see if it's the right fit for the Champaign Police Department. We do believe we have a great department, great people. We want to give them the best equipment to keep our community safe.
Joe, I know I was involved in a couple of these committees over the last several years, and you spent a lot of time talking about officer recruitment and development and really retention.
Sure. This is a challenging time for our department, just the amount of officers that we've hired in the last 3 years. We've hired 26 officers in the last 3 years, and the next 3 to 5, we anticipate we'll have approximately 31 officers that will be eligible for retirement. Now, that doesn't mean they will all retire, but we have to be prepared for that scenario. So the strategic plan includes sections that address both career development and recruitment. We have a targeted recruitment plan in place that will help us increase and maintain diversity in our workforce. We realize that's very important to not only the police department, but our community. We want our department to reflect the community that we police. In regards to career development, we need to prepare our employees for the future and make sure that they are ready to step into leadership positions when we are not here.
Something that really impressed me in the committee work was that you included spouses of officers and really sought their opinions, and it was very enlightening. Talk a little bit about that.
Sure. I mean, if you really want to speak to my boss, no offense, Chief, but talking to my wife would probably give you some good insight. You know, our spouses are significant others. Mm-hmm. They get to see both sides of the job. It's very important to take input from our spouses, significant others, and if there's any areas that we can improve, if they can help us with that, we should listen.
And they share it.
They share. And in addition to it, it helps us with the employee wellness. A lot of times, if you look at the profession as a whole, a lot of our guys see a lot of different things that are challenging and difficult to deal with, and life happens to us as well. So we want to make sure we take care of our employees and make sure our employees are healthy in all states. And a lot of times by talking with spouses ahead of time, helping them see some of the indicators, if there's problems arising for us, we may have seen too much of the job and might need to get some professional assistance, we're able to do so. There's a lot of things that we're doing around that to work with employee wellness because if we keep our employees healthy and really deal with officer safety issues, then we're going to provide that much better quality service to our citizens, and that's the reason for it.
So as the plan unfolds, as mm-hmm. it becomes clearer, what's next? How do you go about implementing this plan?
Well, the next steps is take the time, share the information internally and externally. We just finished all the internal conversations, and next week we're going to embark upon, or I should say in the month of April and May, we're going to embark upon having conversations with the community where we're going to go out and have community dialogues. We're looking to have a minimum of 5 dialogues. We're going to have them at various locations throughout the city. So please pay attention to our website and keep up with the social media, city website, and come out and speak with us about our strategic plan. As we're going to move forward, we're going to have a presentation we're going to do for council in the month of June. And so it'll be another opportunity where people can see what we're looking to do. But we're going to be talking about this for several months into the future, looking for opportunities just to engage and collaborate with our community about where we're looking to go as an agency.
A good plan will guide you for a good many years. So this kind of the detail work that you've been doing is really important.
Yes, thank you.
Thanks for being with us today.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
The Champaign Police Department's working in partnership with the community to find ways to improve public safety, and they want you to help and get involved. To learn more, visit champaignpolice.com. Thanks for watching this episode of Champaign Connection. Remember to tune in next time for another look inside the city of Champaign. On behalf of everyone here at the show, thanks for letting us keep you connected.